Recently, I've been on the road a lot, and when I'm driving, I typically have NPR. It's a great way to keep up with the very, almost seemingly impossible to keep up with the news these days. And recently, this past week as I was driving, I was listening to one of my favorite programs, 1A. And on 1A, they were talking with the CEO for Dollar General. This kind of perked my interest because of our Dollar General store in town, and because I've shopped there from time to time myself. So I was kind of curious what he had to say. And the person interviewing him specifically asked him about his faith, his Christian faith. And so the CEO talked about his experience as a child, his experience with the divine. It was when he was about 11. He was waiting to get picked up. As many of us can remember in our own lives, sitting there waiting for our ride. And he was thinking, he didn't really talk about how he got on the street. In fact, he distanced himself a little bit. He talked about this as if this had happened to someone else. I don't know if it was because of the power of his faith. He talked about sitting there thinking and suddenly realizing that Jesus' death was for him personally as well. That Jesus had died for him specifically too. Now, as we just heard in the gospel, it's not that Jesus died for you, in this sort of discerning specific way. But we hear that Jesus died for the whole world. That God so loved the whole world. But we hear in that love. Love is very, very important. Because that love is what makes it so that each and every one of us is able to have that deep personal relationship with God. Jesus died for the world so that each and every one of us could have this means, could have this relationship with God. Because in our experiences with God, in our experiences with the divine, this is what's really important about them, because they're meant to bring us closer in our relationship with God. They're meant to bring us deeper into that relationship. And just as the CEO for Dollar General had his experience, we all have our own stories. We all have these stories of our encounter with God, and they take place in different ways. Some of us may have more intellectual experiences. It may come from an understanding of Scripture being open to us, or perhaps from another writer like C.S. Lewis. For myself, this experience was spread over time. It started with my confirmation with Bishop Parsley in this diocese, and then it spread to another place with my call to ministry at Winchester Cathedral, and then my discerning of that call even further shortly after to Zay, as I've talked about before in classes here, and as I've talked about specifically with Zay in our Lenten Lunch series this week. We had another great story at our Lenten Lunch series. Irving Jones talked about his experiencing the love of God in his life, specifically through our diocese, and specifically through the efforts of the Sawyerville Day Camp, those folks who helped with that, that went out and talked with the diocese and helped Herman Jones to have his house. rebuilt after the 2011 tornado. It was another experience like that. Others may have a more mystical experience, like we hear about in Isaiah, this experience of his vision in the temple, with God saying, with him saying to God, as God is saying, "Who can I send?" Isaiah is saying, "Here am I, send me." And in fact, particularly those who read Scripture, who have their experience with the divine that way, some people have that experience through reading about the experience of others. In fact, Jonathan Myrick Daniels, who we in the Episcopal Church celebrate as a martyr, Jonathan Myrick Daniels came to his understanding that he needed to be involved in the civil rights movement, that he needed to come down here to Alabama to do that, that he needed to go to Haynesville, not far from here, where in August there will be a march commemorating this event, that he came down to Haynesville and was shot and martyred to save young Ruby Sale from being shot as well. So Jonathan Myrick Daniels came and did all those things because he heard this passage that we read from Isaiah this morning. He heard this passage and he so identified with Isaiah saying, "Here am I, send me," that he went out all the way from being at Episcopal Divinity School in Cambridge, Massachusetts, and came here to be part of the work that God was doing in the civil rights movement. So in all these different ways that God is speaking to us, I bet that if I spoke to each and every one of you here today, and those who will be listening later online, that if I talked to each and every one of you, you would have a different kind of experience with this, a different kind of spiritual experience that brought you closer to God, that brought you closer in relationship with God. Now, for the whole church, we celebrate that relationship, our relationship as a church, in one word, Trinity. That's the very thing that we are celebrating this morning, the Holy Trinity. Now, you'll probably have noticed in our readings this morning that we zero in specifically on the Holy Spirit in the Trinity. There's many who have speculated about this, wondered about this, and there's many who say that's because the Holy Spirit often gets neglected in our talking about the Trinity. We see that a little bit in brief. The Father gets a short little paragraph right at the beginning of brief, and then we get the Son. The Son gets this really long paragraph when we talk about the Son. Then the Holy Spirit gets what really amounts to one sentence. And then right after that sentence, we go and talk about the church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, all of those things. The Holy Spirit doesn't really get that much talking about in the creed. However, we had a whole celebration for the Spirit last week, on Sunday, on the day of Pentecost. Because in the day of Pentecost, we celebrate the Holy Spirit coming down and dwelling with the apostles, and then going forth from there, dwelling with the rest of the followers of the way, followers of Jesus, those who became Christians. We celebrate that Holy Spirit dwelling with us still. In fact, last week, too, we celebrated the Holy Spirit coming down in baptism. We even marked that. We talked about the Holy Spirit coming down over the water in baptism. We talked about the Holy Spirit as we marked Monroe, who's with us here today, too. We talked about marking her with the Holy Spirit after that baptism with oil. We talked about the Holy Spirit coming down every Sunday in our Eucharistic service. Keep a note of it when we get to it in our Eucharistic prayer. We talk about the Holy Spirit coming down on the gifts. And the gifts of bread and wine. I'd be remiss in this season, and in fact, I think this is why I'm thinking yesterday, because this season has been one of ordinations, as it usually is at this time. We had an ordination down in Montgomery yesterday, and we had one in Birmingham the week before, on these Saturdays before our big services on Sunday. In fact, it was almost 2 weeks ago, it'll be 2 weeks from tomorrow, that I celebrated 2 years of ordination for my ordination as a deacon. And it's in these services of ordination, where we call the Holy Spirit to come down on the ordinand to make them a deacon or a priest, or even a bishop for some. That's what we do in those ordination services. Calling down the Spirit to increase, to set aside that person for specific ministry. We celebrated in baptism. We celebrated it last week in the coming down of the Holy Spirit on the apostles. And it's in all of these events, and it's in what we hear this morning from Paul and from Jesus in the gospel. We hear about the Spirit coming down and transforming us. The Spirit comes down and transforms our lives, transforms who we are. And it's also in our conversations in the past several weeks that we hear about the Spirit. That we hear not only, as we will say in the creeds, it's speaking through the prophets like Isaiah, but we hear of Jesus proclaiming his coming, talking about it coming into our lives. We hear in John of Jesus talking about last week the Spirit as an advocate, a helper. The Spirit is being with us when Jesus is no longer with us. We even hear in John of Jesus breathing the Holy Spirit on the disciples and the apostles. We hear of the Holy Spirit coming forth after Jesus is present with us, to be present with us still. Through Jesus, we have that first way in which we're able to be in relationship with God. Because it's through Jesus that we see God as man. That we see God walking around with us as another human being. As someone that we can talk to, that we can be in relationship with. It's through Jesus that we hear of how we're able to live in relationship with God. And for that reason, Christian formation is so important to our lives because it helps continue that work that Jesus did all those thousands of years ago. And then after Jesus, we get the Holy Spirit. God is no longer something separate. And now, even though Jesus has ascended into heaven, God is still there with us. God is still present within our very lives through the Holy Spirit coming and being a part of us. And so it's through this that we get almost a line with the Trinity, a line or a bridge that leads us back to God the Father. Because our relationship now is so deep, thanks to Jesus coming into the world, and thanks to the gift of the Holy Spirit, that we can now be in that intimate relationship with God always. Because the Holy Spirit dwells in us, that Spirit that brings us closer to Christ Jesus. Jesus, who is the Father incarnate as the Son in human form. So as we celebrate the Trinity today, we celebrate that ability to be in relationship with God again. But we're reminded, too, that we're not talking about three separate entities. We talk about the Trinity as three persons of God. Three persons who are yet in unity. The three in one. We talk about Trinity only as unity. There's a couple of reasons that God may reveal himself to us. One is maybe it's saying something to us about ourselves. This is something I've been hearing quite a bit. We think of ourselves as mind, body, and spirit. Three things. Three separate things that are yet one in us. But I think far more likely that God is trying to tell us by revealing himself in Trinity is that we are called to be one with one another. We are called to be one in community, just as God is one within himself in three persons. So as you walk away from here this morning, as you remember the Trinity, as we celebrate that this morning, remember that Trinity is our way in which, as a church, we recognize that relationship with God. Because that is what we hold. Each and every one of us has had some experience with God. At least I hope each and every one of us here today online has had that experience with God. But this is how we as a church understand it. Through Trinity, through the three in one. But also, this idea of Trinity helps each and every one of us to be in relationship, to have those experiences of divinity in our lives, because it helps us to recognize the pull that God has in trying to bring us back to himself. It helps us to remember not only that God came and died for each and every one of us, that God died in order to bring us back into relationship with him, but it reminds us that God still dwells with us, each and every day, not just on Sunday, but each and every day